And so we're grateful that you're here. Thankful, of course, for all of our members that are here. But we have quite a few guests with us tonight, and we're grateful for that. So if you're visiting with us tonight, please know that we're thankful that you've come our way. And we hope that if we haven't had the opportunity to say hello on a personal level, that we'll have the opportunity to do that at some point this evening. We are having two sessions tonight, this one, and then after Eric finishes, we'll take a little break, stretch your legs break, and then we'll have a second session after that. And so we're looking forward to those lessons, grateful that Eric is here and that his lovely wife Vanessa has joined him this week, we were privileged to get a good start last night and looking forward to the lessons tonight. Dean Mannon's going to be leading our singing, and at the appropriate time, Brother Hayden Evans will lead our opening prayer after a couple of songs. Hayden is a 2020 graduate of the School of Preaching here and works with the church in Crandall, and we're grateful that he came over tonight. And then at the end of this session, Brother Grant Puckett, a former member here, but now a member and an elder at the church in Colleyville. We're thankful that Grant and Lisa came over tonight. Grant will lead us in prayer at the conclusion of this session tonight. So let's sing together and worship together. Thanks for coming.
Well, I thought we were going to have slides. I just let the guys in the booth know that we do. There was a PowerPoint sent, so if you find that, you can put it up there. But for now, let's just go with the book, 732. We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Alleluia, thine the glory, alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thine the glory, revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for thy Spirit of light, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Alleluia, thine the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thine the glory. Revive us again. All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Alleluia, thine the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thine the glory. Revive us again. All glory and praise to the God of all grace, who has bought us and sought us and guided our ways. Alleluia, thine the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thine the glory. Revive us again. Revive us again. Fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Alleluia, thine the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thine the glory. Revive us again. Next song will be number 462.
a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by every foe, that will not tremble on the brink of any earthly woe, that will not murmur or complain beneath the chastening rod, but in the hour of grief or pain will lean upon its God. A faith that shines more bright and clear when tempests rage without, that when in danger knows no fear, in darkness feels no doubt. Lord, give us such a faith as this, and then whatever may come, we'll taste in here the hallowed bliss of an eternal home.
Have our prayer at this time.
You'll bow with me. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you at this time so thankful and grateful to be able to come together here as your people. Father, to be able to partake in this gospel meeting, to hear these words proclaimed from your word. Father, that they would encourage us and strengthen our faith. Father, that we would take these matters to heart, that we would continue to diligently seek you out each and every day, that we would apply these things to our lives and be a light and a guide to others to point the way to your Son, Jesus. Father, we thank you so much for Brother Owens and the time that he has taken to come our way and to prepare these lessons, to engage in the ministry, Father, that you have had him to do. And so we are thankful that he can come here and share these wonderful words with us. And Father, we just ask that you would continue to watch over him and his family, bless them wherever they may go, Father, as you've always continued to do, and to bless each and every one of us for having been here. We love you so much, and we thank you most of all for your Son, Jesus, and we offer this prayer in his name. Amen.
Just for the lesson, we'll sing 244, Hold to God's Unchanging Hand.
Time is filled with swift transition. Naught of earth or move can stand. Build your hope on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hope on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Trust in him who will not leave you. What
Good evening. It's good to see you tonight. We are again very thrilled that you are here. It's again great for us to be here. We're very thankful and appreciative of the invitation, and we appreciate the elders and Eddie and those who had a part in our being here. We're very thankful for it. I mentioned my wife last night and being thankful for her being with me. I did not go far enough, so let me tell you just how much I love her and appreciate her, and am so thankful that she has blessed my life and my children's lives, our grandchildren's lives. Such a blessing. No. One of the sisters told me, "You didn't mention your wife last." I said, "I did." "Well, not enough." So there you go. I could say more. We had a great lunch and dinner. Thank you to those who took us out. We learned about some folks here, and we just enjoyed our time together. God is so good, blessing us with a family and with his people, and we're very thankful for that. Tonight, our subject is why religion is not making you happy. We discussed last night three important truths about lasting happiness and why it can't be found here. Lasting happiness is not under the sun. We mentioned that. Lasting happiness is not in anything physical, and lasting happiness comes from God ultimately. And those seeking happiness under the sun will fail for the same reasons Solomon failed. He searched and he searched and he searched, but you'll never find in the book of Ecclesiastes where Solomon grabbed an item and said, "Eureka, Eureka, I found it. This is the thing I've been searching for. This is where happiness is." He never did that because it's not here. His search failed, and it's the same reasons ours will if we search the same way. The pleasures that things give who are physical, ultimately they decrease over time. All physical things wear out and break, and ultimately you're going to die. You cannot take it with you even if you have it. We concluded last night by saying that Christ is the answer. That turns us to religion. And one would think then that the natural progression of the discussion would be, once you find religion, once you turn and draw your attention to the Lord, well, then you will find it. As I said, it's not under the sun, it's beyond the sun. And so one would be reasonable to conclude that if I find religion, I find God, and I'll find happiness. And not true. Not true at all. Not true because not all religions is approved of by God. In fact, there are two kinds of religion mentioned in Scripture and four kinds of worship, and they're not all acceptable to God. James mentions two. James says in James chapter 1 and verse 26, "If any man among you seem to be religious, bridle not his tongue, but deceive his own heart." James says this man's religion is vain. There is such a thing as vain religion. The very next verse, verse 27, begins with these words, "pure religion." There is something called pure religion. There's something called vain religion. There are two kinds of religion, James mentions there, and there are four kinds of worship. Just because a person worships, just because a person turns their attention to God, just because a person becomes religion, it doesn't mean they're going to find the lasting joy that God gives. Those four kinds of worship mentioned in the New Testament, one of them is vain worship. Matthew chapter 15, verse number 8 and verse number 9, Jesus said, "This people draw nigh unto me with their lips, they honor me with their mouth, but their heart is far from me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." An individual could worship God and do it in vain. The idea of vain, empty, useless, pointless, meaningless. A person could offer their worship to God, and God says it's vain worship. Another kind of worship is ignorant worship. In Acts chapter 17 and verse 16, the Bible says this about the Apostle Paul. "Now, while Paul waited for them in Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry." Here are some people who are very religious. Paul says they're idolatrous and his spirit is stirred. This needs to change. And when he met them, verse number 22 of that chapter begins by Paul saying, he stood in the midst of Mars Hill. He said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are," the King James says, "too superstitious." Other renderings will say, "very religious." I see how religious you are. How can I see it? I see all the idols. The very next verse, he says, "For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. Could a person worship ignorantly? Absolutely. Word ignorance is not intended to be an insult. You simply don't know. You don't know what you need to know. And as a result, what you're doing is ignorant. And Paul says, that's what I'm seeing here. There's vain worship. There's ignorant worship. And then Paul mentions something else in Colossians chapter 2 and verse 23. He says, which things have indeed a show of wisdom in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body, not in honoring to the satisfying of the flesh. Another rendering says this of that verse. These have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion. What's will worship? It's self-made religion. There is a fourth one, and that is John chapter 4, verses 23 and 24, where Jesus talking to a woman of Samaria at a well. The discussion turns toward religion in verse number 19, where she begins to talk about the way her fathers once worshiped. They worshiped in this mountain. And then she says of Jesus, and ye Jews say in Jerusalem is where men ought to worship. To which Jesus says, you worship you know not what? Ignorantly. You worship ignorantly. With regards to the Jews, he says, we know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. And then he says this in verse 23, but the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. There is a pure religion, and there is a worship that is acceptable to God. Now, if you find that religion, and if you worship in that way, well, then religion will bring you lasting joy, the religion that comes from God. But friends, that's not the religion that most people have found. If you read John 4, 23 and 24, and you begin to break down the words, you'll read words and phrases like this, true worshipers. Of course, if there are true worshipers, the implication is pretty clear that there are also false worshipers. There is worship the Father in spirit with the right attitude and reverence and godliness. There is truth mentioned. The word of God, John 8, 31, 32, John 17, 17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. It is the right attitude and disposition of heart toward God. And then it is the truth according to God's word. God is spirit, and so the worship will be spiritual. They that worship him must. There are requirements. You must do this a particular way. You worship him in spirit and in truth. What we're talking about, and the reason the title is why religion won't make you happy, is because the world hasn't found what we're describing. What they have found is a worldly religion, a self-made religion. I might refer to it as carnal or fleshly or physical. It's not spiritual, it's material. In keeping with our theme, we might say of it, it's what would happen if you search under the sun, but you use religion under the sun in your search. It's carnal and physical and fleshly. It's the religion that Satan would invent and pawn off as God's religion. It's what he's always done. From the very beginning, Satan has taken God's word and made slight modifications, mixed a little truth with a lot of error, and created something like what God says, similar to what God says. And as we'll talk about in the second hour tonight, one who doesn't have the eyes to see, well, they'll miss it. The devil doesn't mind you worshiping God. The devil doesn't mind you being religious, not at all. Now, he would rather that you didn't if he had his way. But if you decide you're going to follow God, Satan will simply say, I'll come along with you. Satan is described in Scripture as subtle, shrewd, crafty. Jesus also said he is a liar and there is no truth in him. Now, if that individual had a say in religion, what kind would it be? God says worship. the devil would say, yes, I agree. You should worship God, and I'll come along with you to make sure you do it right. How does this subtlety work? Take the phrase, worship God. He says, yes, but shouldn't you get something too? And if you don't get anything, I'm not sure you should even bother worshiping. Oh, worship's supposed to be for God. Satan will say, yes, go right ahead. But you should get something too, shouldn't you? How many people have concluded, I would go, but I didn't get anything out of it? Where'd you get that idea? What about the acts of worship? Well, here's what God prescribed. Satan will say, yes, you should do what God said, but shouldn't you also be able to do what makes you feel good? The spirit of worship. Worship God with the right attitude. Of course you should. But shouldn't you be allowed, as long as you're sincere, shouldn't that be acceptable? Worship God. Yes, you should. But shouldn't you be able to show your talent too? I mean, you are offering it to God. You know, by the time Satan is done with religion, you could go to worship God and then leave angry at God. You could go to worship and say, listen, I didn't get anything out of it. You could go to worship God and be disappointed that you had to go. We got to go back. Was he successful? Has he been effective? Friends, he's been effective. In fact, you know the first time worship, sacrifice is recorded in the Bible, Genesis chapter 4. Satan has always gone to worship. He was there. Cain offered, he sure did. He offered it to God. He just didn't offer what God wanted. John would say he was of the wicked one. Israel offered, they sure did. Just read Exodus 32. They offered, they just used golden calves instead of Jehovah. Has he been successful? Absolutely. Nadab and Abihu, the first priest of Israel, they offered, they just used strange, unauthorized fire. David carried the ark. He just didn't follow the due order. You see, you can go to worship and Satan is good with it, but he's so subtle that you could go to worship God and, like Cain, be angry. David displeased. In fact, you could leave flat out bored to death from worshiping God. Or you can make worship and religion all about you and your needs, and you could actually exclude God except in name only. And that is exactly what religion has done. Religious people are not happy because it's not God's religion they're using. And friends, if you make religion worldly and if you make it an under-the-sun religion, you can have religion, but you won't have God. And therefore, you will not have the lasting joy that he offers. What is it that makes it worldly religion? What is it that makes it different than what Scripture says? Part of what does it is there is no distinction between religious people and non-religious people. You literally cannot tell the difference. And if we're talking about God, he should be the difference. If this is person A and they don't have God in their life, and this is person B and they do have God in their life, one of them should have a joy that can't be taken. One of them should live a life that's different than the other. Why is it worldly religion? Because religion has sought to make sure there's no distinction between someone claiming to live for God and walk with God and emulate God than someone who doesn't. And what you'll find with the God of heaven is that God is a God of distinction. He's very clear about who he is and what's not acceptable to him. In fact, as early as Exodus 32 and verse 26, Moses does what is very clear throughout all the scripture. Literally, the idea of drawing a line in the sand and asking, who is on the Lord's side? There is a distinction between God and not having God. It would have been clear in that day, and it's as clear as Joshua saying the same thing. If it seem evil for you to serve the Lord, then choose you this day whom you will serve. If you'd like to serve the gods of your fathers or the gods of the Amorites in whose lands you dwell, you choose that. But as for me and my house, there's a distinction. You can have those gods, I'll have Jehovah. It's not the same. There is a distinction between God and not having God. Exodus 20 and verse number 3, you shall have no other gods before me. This picture of distinction is drawn throughout the Bible from cover to cover. There is God and the devil. There's the fruit of the Spirit and the works of the flesh. There is the kingdom and the world, light and darkness, good and evil, godly, ungodly, holy, profane, saved, lost, faith, unbelief, truth, false doctrine, moral immorality, contentment, greed, you name it. You could mix these two people up if you tried. And if you saw them and the way they live their lives, there would be a very clear distinction. Material religion, the under the sun religion, there is no distinction. In fact, the under the sun religion is just about equivalent, if not so, to no religion at all. Each has the same key to success, prosperity. Each has the same thoughts of ethics, situational. Each has the same morals, autonomous. Each has the same goal, your best life now. And if asked and pressed, both would tell you, Jesus is not the way, he might be a way. Heard a very popular preacher pressed, is Jesus Christ the way? And he said, well, yes, that's what I believe, that's what I preach. To which he was then queried, well, what about the atheist? Well, I don't judge. Well, what about the Islamic people who don't believe in Jesus but believe in Allah? Well, I don't judge. What about? It didn't matter what the author, what the questioner said. He kept saying, by the end, someone called in and said, I'd like to disagree. Jesus said he's the way, but this very popular preacher kept on saying, his name is Joel Osteen, just if you're wondering. You can YouTube it. Watch him with Larry King. Carnal religion fails to give lasting joy because material religion removes all distinction. And here are four messages that the material religion preaches. These messages are not messages simply from the world. These messages don't simply come from people who are outside and have no affiliation and no desire to follow God. In fact, these messages are preached from pulpits. If I were to ask you, what would be the number one topic preached in prosperity preaching, what would you say? That's our first point. What's the first message in religion? Money. What will make you happy? Money will make you happy. In fact, I have heard them on YouTube and other places brag about how much money they have. And it serves as the key to happiness. When will you be happy? When you get more money. Most religious people and non-religious people believe the exact same thing. If I were to have more money, I would be happy. Now, when it comes to that subject in Scripture, the Bible is very clear. Money won't make you happy. 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning in verse number 6, the Apostle Paul says, now there is great gain in godliness with contentment. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. But having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But those who desire to be rich, what's the problem? The desire to be rich, they fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmless desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. Why? For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. It is through the craving that some have wandered away from the faith, have pierced themselves through with many pains. But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Follow instead, he says, after righteousness, godliness, faith, and love, steadfast steadfastness and gentleness. What is it that people relieve? Religious people and non-religious people. If I get more money, I'll be happy. It's believed despite the evidence to the contrary. We have seen the rich and famous live terribly and very often destructive lives, but they are rich. And if money served as the tool that makes you happy, how come they're not happy? But it's not just them. Religious people believe the exact same thing because it's preached by preachers from pulpits week in, week out. In fact, they're taught, they're waiting for God to give them a blessing. They spend their lives pursuing money. This obsession with seeking money has cost people their reputation, freedom, families. It has sought and given a lot of things, but not happiness. Misery has been found, and still everyone seems to believe the same thing. In fact, you might ask yourself, what's the lottery at now? What if you won it? Wouldn't you be happy with about half of $1.5 billion? One might think so, but let me ask you this. How much does Solomon have? We talked about him last night. They estimated his worth into the trillions. And yet, if money would have made happiness, Solomon should have been the happiest man on the planet. Why won't religion make you happy? Because the messages you hear in religion, they don't have happiness in them. And if you pursue them, you will be pursuing the same thing Solomon sought. What's the second message? It's close to the first, and that is simply possessions. Get more stuff. We don't mind if you grab the next thing. That's where the happiness is. And so we keep on going. Why do you need the money in the first place? It's in part to buy more stuff. And we do. The latest and the greatest, and they keep coming out with more of them. And some people even suggest that our possessions are signs of piety. After all, they manifest how much God is blessing you. Look how much God has given you. You must be living right. You must be pleasing God because he's given you all of this stuff. Let me ask you this. Has it worked? Jesus was walking, as he often did, probably with the crowd, teaching as he often was. Someone on one occasion screamed out to him, "Master, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." This is recorded in Luke 13, down to about verse number 20. To which Jesus said to him, "Who made me a judge over you?" You know, the Savior is here for a lot of things, but to divide up inheritances is not one of them. In fact, we might ask, why couldn't two brothers divide an inheritance equally? Seems like 50-50 would be the way to go. You don't get the insight until Jesus says this. Our Lord said, take care and be on your guard against all covetousness. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things which he possesses. That's actually in the Bible. The Bible would say, if you have food and raiment, be content. The Bible would actually say, your life does not consist. It's not made up. It's not built upon. It's not secured by the possessions you have. And yet, we spend our lives trying to possess more and more things. And Jesus is saying, that's not what your life consists of. Seeking possessions and money has caused a lot of things. Happiness is not one of them, though. In fact, it's very likely that we all got the same thing, debt. The government's in debt. Non-believers are in debt. Believers are in debt. Houses, cars, worst of all, families have been lost over that. We divorce over money, but we had a lot of stuff to divide up. Getting a lot of stuff cannot bring lasting happiness, but it has brought a lot of misery. You know, this book is in question form, so you want to be happy. It's because, in part, people don't generally know what that means. If you knew what it meant to be happy biblically, you might ask, would I still want that? Let me take you back to 1 Timothy 6:10. Food and raiment. How you doing on that scale? If you have food and raiment, learn contentment. There's great gain in godliness if you can meet that, but you're so far past that. You remember the crash of 2008? That's about the time the prosperity preaching was in earnest. I mean, leading up to that, I was hearing it in such a level, it was blowing my mind, the things that was being said. The things I was seeing on YouTube and what was happening was unbelievable. Money was flowing so much, and I kept hearing this phrase, the windows of heaven, the windows of heaven. It's as if they kept saying, God has flung open the windows of heaven and he's pouring you out a blessing. And then the crash happened. I've always wondered how America's economy can raise and lower the windows of heaven. I wouldn't think that an infinite God with infinite resources would have to check the dial before he raised the window and opened them and closed them. But that's exactly what happened. When the crash came, what happened to the windows? Well, they just closed, I guess. Possessions. Get more stuff and you'll be happy. You know, I've heard one of the fastest growing businesses in our country is storage. You know what a lot of people don't have at the house? Room. I've heard of people, well, I won't even ask. You said at some point they say you can go on from preaching to meddling. Let me just put my reverse shoes on right there. I just put them on. But there's people with garages can't park the car inside. You know what you need then? Probably another garage. There's closets full. There's this full. There's that full. There's that full. Why we need a bigger house. You know, the world just keeps pushing you forward. You start with the 3-2, and somebody said, you remember when? Yeah, but now we need a 4-3. And you go a little further, and you need a bigger house. You need a bigger house. You need more garage. You need more garage. Why? Because the world keeps telling you, it's coming. It's coming. The next thing is where you're going to find it. And before you look up, you're asking the same question many of us are asking. Where did all this stuff come from? What are we going to do with it? But the world keeps saying, get more stuff. Number three, the third message from the world is entertainment. You know what will make you happy? Fun. It seems humanity is crazed for fun. We play every day. And in fact, it seems it's become the case that everything we do must be fun. The gaming industry is a huge business. 2022, the revenue from the worldwide gaming market was estimated at almost $347 billion. I watched a show one time called Million Dollar Rooms, not homes. I did not say Million Dollar Homes. I said Million Dollar Rooms. Inside of the home, there was a Million Dollar Room. That room, a game room. One of our children's favorite sayings is, I'm bored. It seems that religion is also entertainment. People don't go to worship God. They go to have church. They go to be entertained and to have fun. I recently saw somebody flying in on strings down in the auditorium. I've seen a man fly in on a parachute and come down because that's what worship is. They go to have fun. They go to be entertained. They go to get something, not to give worship. And prosperity preachers and religion in general has turned it into a party. Often alleging the Holy Spirit is the leader of the hysteria is just not true. But carnal religion fails because it puts self and material before God. When we read John 4:23-24, and we read the idea of true worship, spirit and in truth, that passage says God is the object of worship. That the one we're giving our worship to is the God of heaven. He is seeking such to worship him. But every aspect of life has become entertainment. And so worship must be entertainment. But it's not just worship. We've even turned funerals into celebrations. Grieving people are told, don't you cry for your loved one. Why not? Because we're having a party. It's a home-going celebration. I just don't know how it can be possible not to have a party at the death of a loved one and then cry at the loss of a national championship. We go to a funeral when we have fun, and then we weep if our team loses. Jesus had a friend, and he died. And Jesus knew he was going to die. Jesus went to the tomb with the ability to raise him from the dead. And even then, Jesus wept. But we have to have fun. And if it's not fun, I'm not doing it. And so religion is fun, or I'm not playing. What's happening in the world of religion? It's shrinking. Why not? Not enough fun. And if I don't have fun, I'm not going to do it. What's the fourth thing that they preach over and over again? Pleasure. It's hard to believe this could actually be preached, but it is. Oh, it's not called pleasure. It's called this: no judging. People who profess Christ in name sound like those who deny him. All you got to do is listen. You want to insult a believer, just tell him, are you a Bible thumper? Are you a traditionalist? You one of those people who take the Bible literally? You will watch him run so fast and so far. Oh, no, I'm not that kind of believer. Is there anything wrong? Is there anything a religious person will stand up and say, now that is wrong? Is there anything? Can a Christian, a quote Christian, pronounce any action wrong today? The answer to that is no. And why not? Because God wants me to be happy. And so you can't say anything I do is wrong. The greatest sin you could commit is to judge somebody. And the religious people, not the non-believers, the religious people will take you to Matthew 7, 1 to 5, and completely obliterate the passage. And by the time they're done with it, you can't judge anybody under any circumstances for anything. Do you think you're talking to an atheist? You're not. Do you think you're talking to a humanist? You're not. Do you think you're talking to an agnostic? You're not. You're talking to someone who calls themselves a Christian, and they will tell you, you cannot judge anybody. In fact, they'll tell you further, my God does not judge. To which I scratch my head and ask, have you ever read the Bible? You don't have to read far. Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2 is the creation. By Genesis chapter 3, your God is judging. By Genesis chapter 4, your God is judging. What's it interrupted by? A genealogy in chapter 5. But by chapter 6, God is judging. Three times in six chapters, with two being the creation and one being a genealogy, God judges. If your God doesn't judge, it's because you have a self-made religion. You have a worldly religion, a material religion. And John 7:24, Jesus says, judge not according to appearance, but judge righteous judgments. The result is you can't tell the difference between a religious person and a non-religious person. Go to a club Friday or Saturday night and try to find the distinction between believers and non-believers, and you will not find one. Oh, I did say club. So you might say, well, Eric, you don't know the believers are in the club. Well, yes, they are. They're there. Your first mistake would be to believe they're not there. In the club, in the bar, in the, they're absolutely there. In fact, the DJ is a Christian. The men and women on the floor are Christians. The men and women at the bar are Christians. The singer on the stage is a Christian. The folks exchanging numbers to hook up later, Christians. It's being preached that homosexuality is now acceptable to God. Who's saying that? Well, Eric, of course, the LGBT community. No, listen, they're clearly saying it, but I'm telling you, preachers are saying it. And how would you address? You'd be wrong if you said otherwise. It's believed now by those who call themselves Christians. Their religious groups have voted. People have given their voice and consent. It is now religion that says it's acceptable to God. Question, how would that be different if they weren't religious? Material religion cannot provide you the spiritual blessings of God. Because ultimately, material religion is sinful religion. And there is no lasting happiness in sin. Please understand this. Proverbs 13:15 says, good understanding giveth favor, but the way of transgressors is hard. We said yesterday that you're not just a body, you're a spirit in a body. And the God of heaven is spirit. And the word he gave is spirit. And you are spirit. And if you neglect your spirit for the physical material world, you cannot have the lasting joy that God alone offers. Passages like Romans chapter 1, verse 20 following are completely obliterated by the religious people. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11, completely dismissed by the religious people. Why aren't religious people happy? Because there's no distinction between life with God and life without God. Carnal religion is in the end equal to no religion. Under the sun religion, God no longer makes a difference in one's life. The messages are carnal and fleshly and physical, and people are spending their lives searching for the same things Solomon searched for and seeking them out in the same ways and using religion and simply God in name only. By the end of our time together, we will find it, I promise. But suggesting to you that it's in religion, I would do you a disservice if I led you to believe that simply because you say the name of the Lord, simply because you turn your attention to the Lord, that that alone would give you the blessings that God alone provides, because it's just not true. And our world is evidence of that. I hope you'll stay around for the next session. We'll ask the question, do you have eyes to see? It's possible that you could be religious, have a certain disposition toward God, and completely miss the spiritual things that God is teaching and saying. Let's pray together, and then we'll take a break. Our Father and our God in heaven, we give you thanks and glory and praise. We honor you, Father, for your love and your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Father, for your revelation, for making yourself known and the great mystery and bringing our Lord and our Savior to die for the sins of the world. And Father, we pray that we will submit our hearts, our minds, our spirits to you and follow after those things that you have prescribed, giving you our lives and worshiping you in spirit and in truth and submitting our spirits to you and doing only those things, Father, that bring you glory. Thank you for this congregation. Thank you for this opportunity and for this time together. We give you all praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, it is time for the next session. Once again, glad that you're here, especially if you are visiting with us tonight. Very grateful to have you here and looking forward to the next lesson. We've heard two great ones, one last night, one already tonight, ready for another one. We won't take any more time away from that. We are going to have another song or two before that, so Dean's going to lead us. At the appropriate time, Brother Roger Medina, Rogelio Medina, who works with the Spanish-speaking congregation over at College Hill, is here tonight, and he will lead us in prayer. And then Eric will speak to us and offer the invitation a little bit later. So let's worship together.
Psalm 682, to God be the glory.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, and hear him.
Let us pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we bow before Thee. We thank You, Lord, for Your love, Your grace. We thank You, Father, for giving us the privilege of having this opportunity to be able to hear Your word, to hear in a way, Father, that pierces our heart, that opens our conscience, that allows us, Father, to see the great need, to understand You, Father, understand Your word, and to, Father, to be reminded of the passion and the love that we ought to have and that we ought to strive to be able to teach others to discern Your word. Father, we know that this world is lost, confused, hurting, in pain, suffering in many ways, Father, and that they need of Your truth. Help us, Father, to live lives that bring glory and honor to You, and that not only through our lips Your gospel is proclaimed, but through our lives, Father. Help us to make a difference, to be a difference, and to be able, Father, to teach all those around us in any place that we're at, Father, in any circumstances, that we may give You the glory. Father, continue to be with our brother, our speaker. Continue, Father, to guide him. Continue, Father, to provide him the wisdom. We're thankful for the passion in which he provides Your word to us, Father. We're thankful for the Owens family and for Brother Eric, for his wife, for his children, for the congregation, Father, where he works with. And Lord, we're thankful for the Brown Trail congregation as well. Lord, continue to be with all of us and those watching through the live stream, that you be with them as well, that we may continue, Father, to be encouraged, to be better husbands, children, to be better fathers and mothers, to be better, Father, of your people as we continue to go through life. Father, we praise you. We're thankful for all. It's in Christ that we pray, Lord. Amen.
Number 669, if you're using the book, This Is My Father's World.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature rings, and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, his and the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems all so strong, God is a ruler yet. This is my Father's world. Why should my heart be sad? The Lord is he that heaven bring, God reigns let earth be glad.
You're using the book, the song after the lesson, Song of Invitation, will be number 255.
Again, we appreciate your presence and being with us, and we're very thankful for this time that we've had together, and hope that you can come back and be with us tomorrow. We would love for you to finish up the series. I'd hate for you not to find happiness in a series of happiness. If you have your Bibles, you'd be turning to John chapter 9. That's where we're going to focus our attention for this hour. Having eyes to see, can you see? That's kind of our topic this hour. Are you blind? Spiritual and sight into the things of God. And that's ultimately what's going to help you to be happy. You're going to have to see the spiritual truths of God. And if you're blind to them, well, then you'll miss them, and thus you will not be able to find the happiness you seek. And so if you're in John chapter 9, that's actually the subject of this chapter, and we'll talk about it. A quick outline, kind of just a walk through the chapter. In these first seven verses of John chapter 9, Christ healed a man who was born blind. And after he does that, that really sets up the events of the chapter. From verses 8 down to verse 17, what begins to ensue is that man is then questioned by the Pharisees because of that healing and what he is professing, that he was blind and now he can see. And as a result of being cured, questions are ensuing. And that's what happens from verse 8 to verse 17. When you get to verse 18 down to about verse 23, they're not believing the man, and so they call in his parents. And so from verse 18 to 23, his parents are questioned about this man. And the questions are, is this your son who you say was born blind? And if he is your son, then how does he see? So that they question the parents. They don't believe him. And so they question their parents. Now, from verse, that takes you down to about verse 24 to 34. That man is questioned again. And so the Pharisees return to him. And so Christ heals him. He's questioned. His parents are questioned. Both are not believed. And he's called back a second time. And he's questioned again from verse 24 to 34. And after that questioning, they kick him out. From verse 35 to verse 38, Jesus finds that man. And he comes to know who Jesus is. And he worships him. That's the chapter. And we'll look at it maybe in a little more detail here and pick apart some of those passages. But it does speak more broadly to the book of John itself. In reading this book, it's one of the few books in the Bible that expressly tells you why it's written. You can certainly find out why the other books are written, the subjects addressed, the questions answered, the circumstances dealt with. You can find out why the writer is writing the book, but not John. He just tells us. Near the end of the book, in John chapter 20, verse 30 and 31, John says, "Truly many other things did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, that ye might believe, and that believing you might have life through his name." And so God wants you to believe, but in order to believe, you're going to have to see. You're going to have to see, understand the teachings of the Lord. In fact, leading up to chapter 9, that's kind of been what's taking place already. Jesus has been teaching, and what he has been saying is what's being said this entire book, that he is the Son of God, that he is God in the flesh. He's been saying that, he's been teaching that, and that's been being rejected. In John chapter 8, for instance, verses 23 down to verse 27, he talks about he and the Father. And he was saying to them, "You are from below," verse 23, "I'm from above. You are of this world, I'm not of this world. Therefore I said to you that you will die in your sins. For if you believe not that I am," please understand, you might have the word he italicized in that verse, where you might read Jesus saying, "If you believe not that I am he," but that's not what he's saying. Jesus is rather saying, "For if you believe not that I am, you will die in your sins." Well, who is the I am? That would take you back to Exodus 3 in verse number 14, when Moses met God at the bush, burning but not consumed. And Moses asked God, "Who should I say that you are?" And God said, "I am that I am." And so what Jesus is saying is, if you don't believe that I am God, I'm equal to the Father. If you don't believe that, you will die in your sins, and where I am, you cannot come. But if you're there in chapter 8 and verse 24, just keep reading. Verse 25 says, "So they were saying to him, 'Who are you?' Jesus said to them, 'What I've been saying to you from the beginning, I have many things to speak in the judge concerning you, but he who sent me is true, and the things which I heard from him, these I speak to the world.'" Verse 27 says, they did not realize. They couldn't see it. They did not realize that he had been speaking to them about the Father. John chapter 9 is going to continue that thinking. Their inability to see the teachings, see and understand what Jesus is saying. Their physical focus, this same material under the sun, carnal approach to life, led them to miss, could not see, the spiritual teaching of Jesus. It wasn't just teaching, though. There was evidence. They reject the evidence, and they reject the witnesses. What is it that would evidence that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of God? At least one of the things would have been signs. Miracles. What happened in John chapter 9? Well, in John 9, verses 1 to 5, he heals a man of blindness. Was there evidence for it? Absolutely. Notice how they respond to the man. Notice in John 9, and look at verse 26. When I say they refuse the evidence, they're talking to a man who was blind. And in verse 25, he says to them, whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know. But one thing I know, I was blind, but now I see. These are the people who then questioned his parents. They didn't believe him. Is this your son? Yes. You say he was born blind. He was. You know, it's not the kind of thing people just go around saying. How does he see? I don't know. Ask him. Well, they do ask him again. And this is what he says to them. Now, note their reaction to that in verse 26. So they said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I told you already. You did not listen. Why do you not hear it? Why do you want to hear it again? You don't want to become his disciples, do you? They reviled him and they said, you are his disciples. But we are disciples of Moses. Notice verse 29. We know that God has spoken to Moses. But as for this man, we do not know where he is from. Let me ask you a question. How did they know God spoke to Moses? You know, if you go back to Exodus chapter 3, God says to Moses, I've seen my people suffering. I've heard their groanings. I've come down to deliver them. And now go, I'll send you. And Moses says, I'm not the one. Don't send me. And Moses says, who are you? And God says, I am that I am. That's chapter 3. When you get to chapter 4 in verse number 1, Moses says, secondly, they won't believe me. They won't believe that you talk to me. To which God says, that rod that's in your hand, drop it. And it became a serpent, and he picked it up, and it became back to a staff. And you know what Exodus 4 and about verse number 5 says? That they might believe. What's the thing that's going to make them believe that I appear to you? This sign, this miracle. What's the second one? Put your hand in your bosom and take it out again. It's leprous, it's whole. And he says, if they don't believe the first sign, this now gets you down to about verse number 8 of chapter 4, and he says they'll believe the second sign. God even gives Moses a third sign, the water to blood. Not the plague, but the water to blood, Exodus chapter 4. You know, the purpose of that is when they see the signs, they'll believe. Now, these people say, we know God spoke to Moses. How do you know that? Signs. But as for this man, question, what did this man just do? A sign. Why don't you see him? We don't want him. They couldn't see it. They didn't just refuse the evidence, they refused the witnesses. Go back to John chapter 5 and listen to what Jesus says with regards to others who have testified about him. They simply could not see it. In John chapter 5 and verse 31, Jesus says, I alone testify about myself. If I alone testify about myself, my testimony is not true. But there's another who testifies of me, and I know the testimony which he gives of me is true. Well, Lord, who testifies about you? In verse number 33, he says, you sent to John. He testified to the truth. Well, you read John chapter 1 and chapter 2, and they did. They sent to John, and John says, I'm not him, but there is coming one after me. Shoe latches, I'm not worthy to unloose. Behold, the Lamb of God takes away the sins of the world. This is him. John testified, Jesus says. Go a little further down to verse number 36, where Jesus says, but the testimony which I have is greater than the testimony of John, for the works which the Father has given me to accomplish, the very works I do, testify about me, that the Father has sent me. John testified, the works testified, but there's more than that. In fact, in verse 37, Jesus said, and the Father who sent me, he testified of me. If somebody said, bring in the witnesses, well, what if John testified? And what if the works testified? And what if the Father testified, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye him, the Father that sent me. He testified, but it's more than that. In John chapter 5 and verse 39, he says, you search the scriptures because you think in them you have eternal life. What do? These are they which testify of me. The very scriptures you read testify of me. By the time he ends this chapter, he returns to Moses, and he says in verse 46, for if you believe Moses, you would have believed me. Why? For he wrote of me. They could not and did not see. The man's opened eyes did three things. It validated the genuineness of Christ's claim. He was the Messiah. No man, no sinner could do such things. Please understand as you read John chapter 9, the word sinner will be used a couple of times. Once it's used of the man, they say, you're born a sinner. That's what they say of him. And the apostles ask and then the Pharisees accuse. But it's also used of Jesus. The one they're alleging is a sinner is Jesus. And it's the man who was born blind that says, verse 31, he's not talking about prayer. No, in verse 25, he says it first. He then answered, whether he, Christ, is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know, though I was blind, I now see. But look at verse 31. We know that God does not hear sinners. But if anyone is God-fearing and does his will, he hears him. He's talking about Jesus. He couldn't do these things if he were a sinner. It validated the claims of Christ. It transformed the man's life. He once was blind, but now he can see. He could go about himself. He could move about, guide himself. He didn't need help anymore. He wasn't restricted or limited anyway. He was free. His sight changed his life. It also, though, revealed who was truly blind. And if there is a key takeaway, it's that one. You see, as you read through this chapter, you will meet a man who is physically blind, and he will be given his sight. I once was blind physically, but now I see physically. You will also meet people who could see physically, but were blind spiritually. Notice chapter 40 and verse 41. Those of the Pharisees who were with him heard these things and said to him, we are not blind too, are we? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But since you say we see, your sin remains. By the time you end this chapter, there will be a man who was blind physically but meets the Christ and could now see spiritually. And there are people who are able to see physically and believe themselves to see spiritually but are blind and cannot see. They could not see that Jesus was the Christ. They could not see that he was divine. They could not see that he was God in the flesh. Is a constant contrast in this book. Jesus would speak one thing spiritually, teaching a spiritual lesson, and the religious people would miss it and think physically. If you start in John chapter 2 from about verse 18 to 22, Jesus will say, destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it. And they will say, 40 and 6 years, this building, this temple. Which temple is he talking about? By the time you get to verse 22, he's speaking about the temple of his body and how he'll die, not the physical building. When you turn to chapter 3, you'll meet a man named Nicodemus, a Pharisee, who comes to Jesus by night. And they began to discuss a new birth, being born again. And Nicodemus will ask, can a man enter a second time into his mother's womb for a second physical birth? To which Jesus will say at some point, are you not a teacher in Israel? And you don't know these things? The new birth is not a physical birth. You will read John chapter 4 and you'll meet a woman going to a well to get some water. You know what Jesus does? Turn the discussion to the spiritual. And he says, if you knew who it was that asked you of water, you would have asked me and I would have given you living water. What kind of water? Well, if you give me that water, I'll never come back to this well. He's not talking about water you get from the well. He's talking about spiritual water, living water, never thirst again. In chapter 5, there's the resurrection. In chapter 6, it's the bread from heaven. Which is it? The bread that our fathers ate, Jesus said, God didn't give you. Moses didn't give you the true manna. No, your fathers ate bread and they died. But the bread from heaven is he. It's not manna. It's not a wafer. It's he. The one who is coming to die for the sins of the world. If you eat my flesh and drink my blood. And from that day, many of his disciples walked no more with him. They could not see it. In John chapter 8 and verse 31, beginning down to about the end of that chapter, they talk about freedom. They talk about fathers. We're Abraham's children. Jesus said, if you were Abraham's children, you'd do the works of Abraham. No, you are of your father, the devil. And the works of your father you will do. In John chapter 9, it's blindness. In the scriptures, spiritual blindness is worse than physical blindness. And it is spoken about frequently in both covenants. They were warned, and the prophets prophesied. Isaiah chapter 6, beginning in verse number 9, Isaiah said this. He said, go and say to this people, keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and their ears heavy and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed. Jeremiah said it, Jeremiah 5, 20 and 21, declare this in the house of Jacob, proclaim it in Judah. Hear this, O foolish and senseless people who have eyes but see not, who have ears but hear not. Ezekiel said it, chapter 12, verse 1 and verse 2. The word of the Lord came to me, son of man, you dwell in the midst of a rebellious house who have eyes to see, but see not, who have ears to hear, but hear not, for they are a rebellious house. You know, it's not surprising then when our Lord came and talked to their descendants, the same people, Jesus said, this is why I speak to them in parables, Matthew 13, 13 and 14, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, you will indeed hear, but never understand. You will indeed see, but never perceive. Not surprising then when we get on the other side of the cross of Christ. He dies, he's buried, he rises, he ascends back to glory. The gospel begins to be preached to the same people again. And as it is, Stephen would say it this way in Acts 7:51, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. You do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets did have not your fathers persecuted, and they have slain them, which showed before the coming of the just one whom ye have now been the betrayers and murderers, who have received the law by the disposition of angels and have kept it. You know what they did to Stephen after that sermon? They murdered him too. You go a little further in the book of Acts, and you hear Paul say this. After preaching to religious people, Paul says this, let it be known to you, brothers, that through this man, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and by him everyone who believed is freed from everything from which the law could not be freed by the law of Moses. Beware, therefore, lest what is said in the prophet should come about. Look, you scoffers, be astonished and perish, for I am doing a work in your days, a work that you will not believe, even if someone told you. God does not want us to be blind. And so what he provides is revelation from him. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore I hate every false way. The Lord gives knowledge. Out of his mouth comes wisdom and understanding. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. Revelation from God is among the greatest gifts he's ever given us. And what God tells us in his word is that this world is not all there is. And that you and I are more than material. And that this world and life goes beyond this life. In fact, God says he's spirit. John 4 and verse 24, God is spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. But secondly, God said his word is spirit. In John 6 and verse 63, Jesus says, "It is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." God is spirit. His word is spirit, and you are spirit. Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea. Matthew 10 and verse 28, Jesus says, "Fear not him who can destroy the body, but cannot destroy the soul. But fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." You are more than a spirit, and you need to be able to see spiritually. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 1, the Bible says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. By it the men of old gained approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were made, prepared, or formed by the word of God, so that what is seen was clearly made by that which is not seen." God gave his revelation to give us sight so we could live in this world and see clearly how to prepare to live in the next. If the quest is happiness, if it is, "I want to find a joy that cannot be taken," then you must develop the vision to see the unseen. The Apostle Paul says, "While we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal. The things which are not seen are eternal." To be happy, you have to be able to see three things. And God has revealed them in his word. Number one, the world is temporal. Do you have eyes to see it? Over and over and over again in Scripture, the refrain is, "This world will not last." Take a passage like Hebrews chapter 1 and verse number 10, where the Hebrew writer says, "And you, Lord, laid the foundation of the earth in the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hand." What will happen? He says, "They will perish, but you remain. They will wear out like a garment, like a robe. You will roll them up, but you are the same, and your years will have no end." Since this world is passing away, Scripture then gives us some do's and don'ts about the world. For instance, the Bible will say, "Don't love it here. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is perishing. It's not of the Father. It's perishing," is what John writes. Jesus would say, "Don't lay up your treasures here." It's not simply of not loving it. Jesus says, "Don't even stack up your treasures here." Matthew 16, 19 and 20. "Lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt and where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven." You remember the rich young ruler, that's how we refer to him, the man that ran up to Jesus, knelt down before Jesus, called him good master, asked the right question, "What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus says, "Why do you call me good? There's none good but one, and that's God. You know the commandments." And he says, "Love your neighbor." And he said, "All these things I've done since my youth." Okay, you have one thing left. Go sell all that you have. Give to the poor. Come, take up your cross. Follow me. He went away sorrowful. Why? For he had much possessions. You know what Jesus offered him? Riches in heaven. What if he could have seen it? Can you imagine trading earthly, temporal riches for eternal treasures? He grabbed onto those earthly possessions. Jesus says, "Don't lay up your treasure here," but he couldn't see it. Don't waste your life loving money. You know, I referenced Luke 12 about the two brothers who couldn't make up. You know what? After that, Jesus gave this parable. The parable about the man who had great barns, and he went and built greater barns. I know what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns, and I will build greater barns, and I will have to bestow my goods. Jesus referred to that man as a fool. Since God wants us to see spiritually, since he wants us to see the world as temporal, he told us, don't. But then he told us, this is what you should do. You can find that in Colossians chapter 3. What did he do? Since the world is temporal, do this. Colossians chapter 3 and verse number 1, the Apostle Paul says, therefore, if you have been risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. You're looking for happiness, right? Yes. Where is it? It's not here. So where are you seeking? Seek those things which are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. What else should you do? It's in the next verse. Set your affections. What is it that you love? What is it that gets your heart? What is it that gets your time, your energy, your money? You want to know what a man loves? You want to know where his heart is? Jesus said he can tell you. Where's his heart, Lord? It's where his treasure is. Okay. Well, where's his treasure? You can always tell where people's treasures are. How do you know? All you got to do is see where they spend their time. Where do they spend their money? And where do they spend their resources and effort? You know, we don't have much else to treasure. You know, you don't like people wasting your time. You don't like people doing anything with your time. No time is too valuable to waste. And so wherever I choose to spend my time, that's where I treasure. I'm going to spend my life right there. Well, what about money? It's important. It's valuable. So what do you do with it? I do with it where my heart is. That's what I treasure. You find my money, my time, and me. Energy, effort, and life, you will find my treasure. Seek those things above. Set your affections on things above. And the third thing he says is sacrifice yourself. That'll take you from verse 4 down to verse number 10. What are you supposed to do? Mortify your flesh, verse number 5, beginning, which is on this earth. All of those things, you stop them. You take off the old man. You put on the new man. Seek those things above. Set your affection. Sacrifice yourself. Why? Because this world is temporal. Some indications you might be blind. Maybe you don't see it. How would I know? You know, if you put physical things above spiritual things, you might be blind. You may not be able to see that spiritual truth. If you love this world more than you do the next, it might be because you're blind and can't see it. If you think more of possessions than you think of people, it might be the case that you're blind and can't see it. If you place more emphasis on your physical man than you do your spiritual man, it might be the case that you can't see it. You know, it's an amazing thing that far too many religious people believe the work of their preacher is to give them spiritual life. That my spiritual life is as healthy as my preacher's last sermon. Well, I'm sorry, but that's not the way it works. Who's in charge of growing your faith? Who's in charge of strengthening your prayer life? Who's in charge of you learning more scripture? Well, that would be you. And if every other thing on the planet gets you rather than your spiritual man's growth and development, it might be the case that you can't see it. If you hoard and hold things rather than share and give, it might be the case that you're missing God's spiritual message that this world is temporal. God has an amazing way because he rarely stops at one thing. There's always an and with God. And if he were to start way out here and say, listen, Eric, I'd like you to know I put you on this earth, but this earth won't last. God would then say, please see number 2. God wants you to see that your life is short. Do you have eyes to see it? Oh, it's not simply that the world is passing away. God would want you to know, Eric, your time on that earth is short. we often cite Methuselah. He lived to be 969 years old. But there is a refrain in Genesis chapter 5 that you should become familiar with, because no matter the name and the number, eventually it says this, except for one, it says, and he died. One man walked with God and he was not, for God took him, but everybody else, and he died. You know, the Bible wants us to know this. God wants us to know this. And so he says it over and over and over again. In 1 Chronicles 29 and verse 15, he says, our days are like a shadow. Psalm 102 and verse number 11, he says, it's an evening shadow. It's not even the whole day. No, take the evening. It's a shadow within the evening. James says, it's a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. David says in Psalm 34 and verse number 5, my days are a hand breadth. Job says they are few and troubled. Job 14 1 and 2. Like a flower, it withers, and like a shadow, it continues not. The years of our days, 70, if by reason of strength they be 80. So teach us to number our days so we may apply our hearts to wisdom. One of the things, and every time I talk about this section or this subject in any sermon, it's important for me to help you understand that all of the imagery, shadows, hand breath, vapors, that is descriptive of the entire 80 years. What does that say about the many of us who are a long way toward the 80? If the whole thing is a shadow, if the whole thing is a vapor, what do you hear God trying to tell us? Can you see it? That life is short. Your time here is not very long. You might be blind. If your emphasis is physical instead of spiritual, you might be blind. If your spouse and your children are not your number one priority, you might be blind. Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verses 7 to 12, that great section of scripture where Moses calls the entire nation together. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might. Please understand, as you read that section of scripture, Moses is talking to the adults. He's talking to those who are parents. And every action in that section is theirs. What he says to the adult people who have the children, these words shall be in your heart, and then you shall teach them diligently to your children. When you rise up, when you walk through the way, when you lay down at night, write them upon the frontlets of your house. It's not the children. Too many people have children and treat them like dolls and or friends. If you have a child, please understand, heaven's perspective is that you will teach that child God, and that you will help them one day make a proper informed decision to follow God, so you and they can get to heaven and be with God. That's not the church's responsibility. That's not the preacher's responsibility. That's not the government's or the school's or somebody else's responsibility. That is the parent's responsibility. Now, you might be blind if you can't see that. If you think you're going to neglect that and then guilt the church 15, 16 years later, lamb blast the preacher, tear down the elders, and tell everybody who was listening how the church has failed your children and how we keep losing all of our children. I'm simply amazed that as a group we have bought that. The church doesn't have children. The church has members. Homes have children. And God intends for them to be reared to seek Him by those parents. And if you can't see it, you might be blind. If eternity doesn't affect your present decisions, then you might be blind to the reality that you don't have much time here. I said God would start way out here, and He does. And then you can see Him narrowing it down. Eric, yes, please fix it in your mind that at some point this whole thing I made will end. 2 Peter 3, it will. And Eric, please understand, your time on it, it's not that. But God has an amazing way of getting even smaller. The third thing that God wants us to see is that tomorrow is not promised. I ask you, do you have eyes to see it? Does the scripture warn about it? Absolutely. Do not boast yourselves about tomorrow. Why not? For you don't know what a day may bring forth. Proverbs 27:1. Be angry and sin not, and do not let the sun go down on your wrath. Ephesians 4 and verse 26. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear His voice, harden not your heart as in the rebellion in the day of testing in the wilderness. What's God saying? The world is temporal. Yes, your time is short. Got it. But can you see? Tomorrow's not promised. You know, it's one of those things that no matter how many times you hear it, it sinks in, maybe for just a moment. But somehow, amazingly, we go out, we leave the doors, we get out into the cool of the air, and then somehow we get back to our calendars. And somehow we lead ourselves to believe, yeah, seemed like a good idea at the time. You know, that was really interesting. You know, I do agree with that. Turns out we don't know. And then, but you know, we got this thing next week. Let me offer you a couple of dates, get you to think about it for just a moment. What if I toss this date at you? December 6, 1941. Mean anything? Here's another one. September 10th, 2001. Mean anything? What happened 24 hours later? The world changed. You see, December 6th gave rise to December 7th, 1941. A day that will go down in infamy is what we heard. September 10th gave rise to September 11th. You remember that day, but what was the difference? Just one day. You might be blind. You could be blind if you didn't live yesterday. Like it could have been your last day, you probably can't see it. If you came here tonight holding a grudge you'll take with you, you probably can't see it. You're living unfaithfully to the God of heaven, and you know it, and He knows it. It's because you probably can't see it. If you know you need to repent, but you refuse to repent, it's because you probably can't see it. You know you need to obey the gospel. You visited 100 times. You keep putting it off. You probably can't see it. I had a conversation with my brother this afternoon, who is also a gospel preacher. He said, you know, What I tell people is the next time somebody doesn't obey the gospel, he says, maybe you should say this to them. He said, ask them, how long is your covenant? I'm listening. I'm like, okay. He said, how long is your covenant? I said, I don't know. What does that mean? He said, it's what happened in the days of Isaiah. He said, the people made a covenant with death. And they behave in that covenant as if death said, I won't visit you for another 10, 20 years. And maybe you've made such a covenant. Maybe you and death have agreed that he won't visit you for 10 to 20 years. And so you got time. Let me ask you, have you made such a covenant? Is there something you know that neither the God, that nobody else knows, but you know you're going to be here tomorrow? You know you have time next week. You just know it. Can you imagine what somebody would do if they could see it? Imagine how the man's life changed once he was able to see. Can you imagine how happy he was once he was able to see? But what if you can't? And you'll be just like those people we read about. They had Jesus in their midst, and they couldn't see it. In fact, that man who starts out blind without Jesus ends with these words. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he found him, he said unto him, dost thou believe on the Son of God? He answered and said, who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him? And Jesus said to him, thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. And he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world, that they which see, that they which see not might see, and they which see might be made blind. If you're searching for happiness, friends, it's beyond the sun. It's spiritual in nature. It comes from heaven, and you're going to have to develop the spiritual sight to see it. I ask you tonight, are you blind? Or can you see? The world is temporal. You don't have much time. And tomorrow is not promised. We beg you tonight, if you can see it, and if you need the Savior, would you come? Would you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? John 8, he is. Would you repent and change your heart and your mind? Jesus said you must, Luke 13, 3. Would you confess his name? You know we didn't read it, but it's the one thing the Jews refused to do. The idea of confession literally means to say the same thing. You know what Jesus wanted them to say? The same thing he said. I am the Son of God. They refused to say it. They even went so far as saying, if you confess it, we'll put you out. Jesus says, you must confess it. And then be baptized, immersed in water for the forgiveness of your sins, and God will wash away all your sins, make you a new creation, and you can live a life that sees it. Friends, if you are his child, you know everything we've talked about tonight and this week is not limited to those in the world, because it can happen to us. You can be in the kingdom and begin to live a material, earthly, fleshly religion. You can turn God's goodness into the exact same thing the world does, and you can miss the spiritual truths of God. Friends, if you need to repent, we beg you, please come home to Jesus. If we can help you in any way, we invite as we stand and as we sing.
Oh,
Thank you, Dean, for the song leading tonight, and thank you, Eric, for the two excellent lessons. We appreciate it so much. Glad that you're here. You're challenging us and encouraging us and all of that, and we're so grateful that you've come our way. And thank all of you for being here tonight. Just a couple of things that I don't want to forget. One, Eric does have some books out in the foyer. If you didn't happen to see those when you came in, on a table out there, books that he's written that you can purchase there. And one of them has to do with the theme of this series of lessons about true happiness. And he has one, the primary book that he wrote on that subject, and then he has another for on the same subject, geared more towards teens, young people. And so avail yourselves of those and purchase those for your own use or perhaps gifts for others. Then tomorrow we'll finish the series of lessons. Tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock will be the first lesson, and then we'll have another right after that at 11 o'clock. And so if you can be here for that, please do. Come and see what he has in store for us to finish out this series of studies. So thank you for coming. I'll ask you to stand if you don't mind. And we'll go to our Father in prayer and be dismissed. Gracious Father, we thank you for the blessing of this time together. We thank you for the opportunity to blend our voices together in song and offer our worship and praise to you. And we're thankful for the time that we've had to listen to your word faithfully and powerfully proclaimed. We thank you for your servant, Eric, and for what he's doing for us over these last couple of days and for tomorrow. And thankful for the work that he does throughout the kingdom. And we pray, Father, that we would be not only diligent listeners, but that we would be doers of the word and not hearers only. We pray, Father, that we would always put your will above our own. And we ask that you would bless us this evening with safe travel home. We pray that you would bless us, if it's your will, with a good day tomorrow. In Jesus' name, amen.